It looks like if we want to save our planet, we will have to change our lifestyle. An organic vegan diet would definitely resolve many of the problems our world is facing today.
Yes, it's getting easier to be a vegan. More and more restaurants are offering vegan options. There are even chains of vegan restaurants being opened up around the world.
So it's becoming easier to make the change. And speaking of being able to make changes, we are pleased to present two incredible contortionists from Mongolia.
Narangwa Dulamsaran and Hungerzul Tienadov are talented artists who are currently performing with the world-renowned Cirque du Soleil in Las Vegas. They have won several awards, including the gold medal at the 2006 International Circus Artist Competition in Latina, Italy. For our conference this afternoon, they have prepared a magnificent performance called Swan Dreams. Please give a warm round of applause to Narangwa and Hungerzul.
Thank you.
That was just amazing. And they look just like swans. Let's give them another round of applause. These incredible young people from Mongolia.
The beauty of that act reminds me of Supreme Master Ching Hai. Out of her loving oneness with all animals, Supreme Master Ching Hai has penned three international bestsellers: The Dogs in My Life, The Birds in My Life, and The Noble Wilds. While she was writing The Noble Wilds, Master Ching Hai became acquainted with a family of wild swans and was able to communicate with them telepathically. She discovered that swans have noble qualities that exceed most humans.
One day, the mother swan told Supreme Master Ching Hai, "We do not have to use verbal language. We communicate in silence. We do not need to talk about love, harmony, and peace. We live in them." In other words, swans simply exude unconditional love.
Now, getting back to our topic of global warming, let's find out how some cities around the world are taking concrete steps to halt climate change. We will now hear from their leaders.
Good afternoon. My name is Larry Falcon. I'm director of the City of Cincinnati's Office of Environmental Quality, and I'd like to send my greetings to Supreme Master Ching Hai and all of the participants in this conference. The City of Cincinnati has adopted a Green Cincinnati Plan, which is the city's Climate Protection Action Plan. What we did is we got together a large cross-section of the community, both leaders of the business community, labor community, and nonprofit organizations, and had them help us identify things that could be done in Cincinnati that would reduce our contributions to global climate change and at the same time improve our local environment, improve our local economy, save more money than it costs, improve public health, set out to achieve all of those objectives simultaneously. What we found, and we're very happy to find, is that most of the things that we would do to reduce climate change are things that we had good reason to do anyway, that did save more money than they cost, that did improve local public health, that did improve the local environment. One example of a recommendation in the Green Cincinnati Plan is to encourage residents of the city to eat less meat. And not only does eating less meat significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions, it also helps people be healthier, helps people save money, does all of those objectives. So a lot of people making personal decisions to alter their lifestyles to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, including by changing their dietary choices. So I want to thank you all for giving me the opportunity to participate in the conference this afternoon, and for sharing the experience of Cincinnati and our efforts to reduce climate change and help people move towards a diet that contains less animal products.
Hello, everybody. Hello, Madame Ching Hai. My name is Daniel Tamont. I'm the mayor of the city of Ghent in Belgium. And already a couple of months ago, we declared Thursday as the Veggie Day, because you know, perhaps all of you, that indeed the production of meat is responsible for 18% of the greenhouse gas emission. That means that we want to do something against it, and we declared Thursday a Veggie Day. But there is more. All our schools, and we have a lot of schools in our city, are also eating vegetable meals on Thursday. And what's more, we're looking now out that all our receptions in our city hall will be veggie receptions. So I hope you have a very good meeting there, that you can do something against the all-over-world emission of greenhouse gas. Thank you very much and a lot of success.
We have made a very, very important decision. We go for veggie. And veggie means that we will sensibilize our citizens to have less meat. And why do we do this important political choice? It's important for the health to eat less meat, but also for the environment. We know that the production of meat gives important environmental problems. So we have given our citizen a book, a little book. All 70,000 citizens have a book with recipes of veggie. We work with the schools, we work with our hospital, we work with organizations to have Thursday our veggie day. So for us, the political choice was important. That's give us the opportunity to do some actions about health and about meat and veggie. So be veggie, go green, and save our planet.
Our thanks to these dedicated statesmen for sharing their success stories. We appreciate and laud their noble leadership.
That's great news that entire cities are working to halt climate change. I wonder if there are other positive developments happening in the world.
Well, Mrs. Hazel Henderson is a distinguished futurist, evolutionary economist, and the author of the best-selling book, Planetary Citizenship. Let's hear what Mrs. Henderson has to say about our future.
I'm very happy to be at this wonderful conference on humanity's leap to the golden era. So greetings to all of you who are there. And we need now to really restore our vision. And so let us now learn from our children and the vision that all children in the world share. And they know that we can build a happy and harmonious and just and peaceful and sustainable future. So we have to thank all of our children for their wonderful vision. And I have worked all of my life in the belief that we humans are standing at the brink now of the solar age. And this is the great transition if we moved to more vegan and vegetarian diets. We would go a long way to reducing the carbon on this planet. What I see happening now is that all of the new companies who are creating healthier food, healthier lifestyles, preventive medical care and fitness, and all the companies who are working in solar energy, in wind energy, all of the other sustainable technologies, making our appliances and all of our energy systems more efficient. Financial crisis and the climate crisis are a huge learning opportunity to help us now shift very rapidly into building this new economy. We have all the technologies we need. We have all of the resources we need. So again, I congratulate you all for being here, and let us all move together to this new golden age, this solar age, where we can all live together on this planet in a healthier, more humane, more just, and more sustainable way of life. Thank you. Be veg, go green, save the planet.
Thank you for your warm wishes, Mrs. Henderson, and for including children in your vision of the future.
Mrs. Henderson talked about the beginning of a new economic era on Earth. But what about people? Will they be different too? Will the children of the new era be more intelligent and more talented?
Akiane Kramarik may be representative of the children of the future. Only 15 years old, Akiane has already been selected by Tribute Entertainment as one of the 20 most accomplished visual artists in the world. Let's hear from this amazing young girl.
Hello, everybody. My name is Akiane Kramarik. I am 15 years old, and I am an artist and a poet. My story began at the age of 4, where I grew up in a family that, you know, did not believe in God. We didn't pray. And one day I started having these visions and dreams about heaven, about different people, different cultures. And I didn't think that my parents or my family was ready to hear it, so I decided to draw them. And the more I drew, the more my parents started believing me, and they started supporting me in my gifts. So I progressed into painting. At the age of 7, I started to write poetry. And I wrote many books, but I've published 2 books. And this is my poetry book, and the first one is about my art. And at the age of 9, Oprah noticed my gift, and after her show, my whole career just boomed. And I was so honored that everybody could know my message. And my message is to bring people together, to unify them, and to realize that love is the answer to everything if we really look at it, at that perspective. And I actually wrote a poem that is about that. And this is called Love. Love is never alone. Love is always crowded. Love is a shared self. We cannot own our love. We cannot teach our love. The longest breath of love is the shortest distance to heaven. The deepest life is love. The deepest love is an embrace. Love is not rest. Love is peace. Love is a purpose. And right after I wrote that poem, I knew that I needed to show people that if we just live together in harmony and live better, you know, myself, I am a vegetarian because there's no need to actually take another life. And I feel better. My artwork is inspiring me each day and inspiring people each day. The future is so much surprises, and I can't wait till I show the world what my message is.
We are grateful for Akiyani's blessings to this world. She represents the hope and promise of a visionary new generation.
Like Akiyani, Supreme Master Ching Hai speaks about hope for a new world, a world of love, compassion, and peace.
Supreme Master Ching Hai also teaches that music is heavenly, especially the music of the harp.
Yes, we often see the images of angels and other heavenly beings playing the celestial instrument. Our next performer, Yasmin Amina Olya from British Columbia, Canada, plays the Celtic harp. She also sings, but in a language that she says is not of this world. She calls it a celestial language of love and light. Yasmin will perform one of her compositions entitled The Beginning. She says it's a song about hope for our world in the light of God's will. Please give a warm welcome to Yasmin Amina Olya.
Sandarla nariyariyay niriyayu
That was truly out of this world. Thank you for sharing your celestial music with us. Please give another round of applause for this exceptional artist, Yasmin Amina Olya.
In just a few moments, our beloved special guest of honor, Supreme Master Ching Hai, world-renowned humanitarian, artist, author, and spiritual teacher, will share her wisdom and vision with us.
Supreme Master Ching Hai has dedicated her life to serving and uplifting all beings, especially those in need. The following video will introduce this beloved teacher.
Truth, virtue, and beauty are universal values and form the fundamental qualities of any inspiring individual. Great arts are inevitably inspired by great love. Each and every one of us has the innate source of love, which can be translated into action. We can paint our canvas of life with kind deeds. Kindness has been considered the core value of human civilization since its origin. Throughout history, planet Earth has been graced by many enlightened beings whose lives were examples of love in action. And many others have inspired humanity to evolve into a more advanced species with higher consciousness and a greater capacity for love. They have shared their lives and their love with all those around them, helping to create a better world. One of the current examples of love in action is Supreme Master Ching Hai, a world-renowned humanitarian, artist, and spiritual teacher. Like many great saintly beings, Supreme Master Ching Hai has shown her great innate compassion towards all forms of life since childhood. It was natural for her to seek a spiritual journey and dedicate her entire life to helping others obtain enlightenment and liberation from their sufferings.
Whatever we can share, begin with sharing. And then we will feel a subtle change in ourselves. More love will be pouring into our consciousness, and we will be aware of something. And that is the beginning. We are here to learn to grow, as well as to learn to use our power, our limitless power of love and creativity, in order to make a better world wherever we happen to be incarnate.
Supreme Master Ching Hai's love and assistance have extended beyond all cultural and racial boundaries to millions of people around the world.
She is the light of a great person, an angel of mercy for all of us.
She was, because you know the presence, you can feel, you don't have to have studied it to know. The people that have it just have to walk in the room. And in her case, everyone gets it. You don't have to be a believer of the same denomination to know the special people, that there's a Moses, a Jesus, a Muhammad, and not deny their speciality. You don't expect one to go with the other, but they all unanimously go, oh. They bow to the specialness when it's present. And it was present that night. Everyone felt it.
Although she does not seek acknowledgement of any kind, in recognition of her selfless assistance, Supreme Master Ching Hai has been given awards worldwide by government officials and private organizations on numerous occasions. They include the World Peace Award, the World Spiritual Leadership Award, Award for Promotion of Human Rights, World Citizen Humanitarian Award, Award for Outstanding Public Service to Mankind, 2006 Goosey Peace Prize, Los Angeles Music Week Certificate of Commendation, First Place Silver for the 27th Annual Telly Awards 2006, and the Presidential Active Lifestyle Award from the 43rd President of the United States, George W. Bush. In addition, October 25th and February 22nd have been proclaimed as the Supreme Master Ching Hai Day in the United States. Congratulatory messages were sent to the Chicago ceremony by many government officials worldwide, including Presidents Clinton, Bush, and Reagan. To commend virtuous actions and encourage others to be inspired by their examples, Supreme Master Ching Hai has created a series of Shining World Awards. Through these prestigious awards, she has recognized deserving humans and animals for their exceptional heroism, compassion, leadership, bravery, or intelligence. Supreme Master Ching Hai is also the source of inspiration to Supreme Master Television, a global station which airs constructive programs with subtitles in over 40 languages. The station encourages harmony, greater understanding, and compassion for all beings. It also promotes an organic vegan lifestyle as the most effective and fastest solution to climate change. Through her tireless dedication to improve the lives of all beings on Earth, Supreme Master Ching Hai has set a true example of love in action. Supreme Master Ching Hai is one of the truly dedicated people of this era, helping others find and create a beautiful vision of our future. Many great people in history have had a dream, and in her own words, so does Supreme Master Ching Hai.
I dream that all the world will become peaceful. I dream that all the killing will stop. I dream that all the children will walk in peace and harmony. I dream that all the nations shake hands with each other, protect each other, and help each other. I dream that our beautiful planet will not be destroyed. It takes billion, billion, trillions of years to produce this planet, and it's so beautiful, so wonderful. I dream that it will continue, but in peace, beauty, and love.
Thank you.
And now comes the moment we have all been waiting for, the moment when we get to greet our special guest of honor, Supreme Master Ching Hai.
Hello, Supreme Master Ching Hai. Wow, you look so beautiful.
Hello, my love. Hello, everyone. Thank you.
We are extremely grateful that you could join us here in Washington, D.C.
Supreme Master Ching Hai, we have been discussing the urgency of climate change and the solutions to many of our problems, and that a vegan diet offers a solution. We also have been talking about the dawn of a new golden era here on Earth.
Yes.
We have many guests with us here this evening, as well as our worldwide viewers who would like to ask you some questions. But before we begin the question and answer session, is there anything you would like to say to our guests and viewers?
Yes, I would like. I would like to thank all the beautiful people for coming. And I'm very honored to be with them once again in the company of the great, good-hearted, intelligent people of America, including the distinguished guests, dignitaries, and illustrious speakers who are leaders in their fields of government, science, environment, and health. I have been listening quietly. Well, I have been in your country, the United States, many times, including the magnificent nation's capital, Washington, D.C. And I have always been welcomed so much, no matter where I go. For this, I'm always grateful. And I have a special place in my heart for the United States of America and her citizens as shining examples of the democratic spirit. I am always impressed by this young, self-made nation that has excelled in strength and leadership through her people's sheer determination, sincerity, and faith. And I believe that the courageous actions needed at this urgent time would be led by Americans. Your high standards of integrity and deep love for your families and country will bring about the crucial steps needed to save our precious planet, our home, and the one we want for our children and grandchildren. May this important event be fruitful and beneficial to the participants and the world. Thank you all for being here. God loves us all. God bless you all. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Supreme Master Ching Hai, for your insightful words. And for your beautiful dress today, you look absolutely gorgeous.
Oh, thank you. This is a vegan fur. Vegan fur, hey? It's not real fur. Yeah.
Yes.
I designed it.
Whoa.
Also, the jewelry, now you know, right? Look at how beautiful. You don't have to wear real fur. It's beautiful.
It's much more beautiful.
Yeah, and you feel so light wearing it because you don't have a bad conscience. Yes.
and so warm, you know. I have something better inside. I also designed it. Ah, look at this. Yeah. Look, be red, go green. Ah, to save the planet.
Master, you look like a queen.
Oh, thanks a lot. Yes, I'm the queen of heart. To the queen of heart is the ace of beauty. All right, let's get down to business because all of you busy.
Well, we have several questions that our guest this evening would like to ask you.
Our first questioner is a software developer named Jerry Pelletier.
My name is, like they said, Jerry Pelletier.
Welcome.
Thank you. My mother, Chan Mo, was a devoted follower of your teachings for many, many years.
Oh, I know her.
Yeah, I knew.
She's a Buddhist nun.
Yes.
Yes, and she's a very, very beautiful woman.
Yes. My question is that this world we share and made up of many countries and the activities of one country affect the health and well-being of other countries. It's kind of the analogy I can make is the smoking and non-smoking sections of a restaurant. So right now I think the world is there's more smokers than non-smokers. So what can we do? Is it just one person at a time? Is it a country at a time? What can we do to get everybody on the same sheet of music to change the way we live, to save this world we live in? Thank you.
Yeah, what can we do? We have to change ourselves first, right? It begins with us. Since time immemorial, you know, evolution always begins with individual. Yes. If we want to change the world, we change ourselves first. Now, even if the government forbids smoking or drinking or drug, but if people individually continue, then we have not make much difference. So now we have to change, huh? For example, we change a little bit, you know, our habit, just a very little bit, like we put down that piece of meat and then we replace it with tofu or some other vegetarian protein. Just a little change, very little change. And then the world will change. And then we will continue to live here, and then we can have a better world. Everything will change for the better. Just little change like that.
Some of the benefits of a vegetarian diet: lowers blood pressure, lowers cholesterol levels, reduces type 2 diabetes, prevents stroke conditions, reverses atherosclerosis, reduces heart disease risk 50%, reduces heart surgery risk 80%, prevents many forms of cancer, stronger immune system, increases life expectancy up to 15 years, higher IQ, saves 70% of the total cost of $40 trillion for reducing global warming, uses 4.5 times less land to grow food, conserves up to 70% clean water, saves 80% of the cleared Amazonian rainforest from animal grazing. A solution for world hunger. Free up 3.4 billion hectares of land. Free up 760 million tons of grain every year, half the world's grain supply. Consumes one-third fossil fuels of those used for meat production. Reduces pollution from untreated animal waste. Maintains cleaner air. Saves 4.5 tons of emissions per U.S. household per year. Stop 80% of global warming. Plus more.
sometimes it takes an impending catastrophe to make us change and become much greater than we were before. Is this what's happening with climate change? Is it, in fact, an opportunity for us to make an unprecedented leap in evolution?
Good question, sir, good question. You see, we should not have waited until we have a catastrophe like this, or impending catastrophe, to change. But nevertheless, you're right. It's possible that when we face with such a great upheaval, then we will change and we make a leap into the next level. Especially now, we still have a little time to change. It's just that we need to act now. You see, to profit from this so-called catastrophic future that awaiting us. We have to act now for all of humanity, because along with our own survival and health, there is an entire planet that is in trouble. And everyone needs to be vegan to save it. It's a very simple solution that we might overlook. Because if we all change into vegan, put down the animal products, then we would have a dream world that I promised. Because like beget like. We forget that the Bible told us that as we sow, so shall we reap. That means if we create peace, compassion, and harmony, then that's what we will get. Now, the impending catastrophe that you mentioned, it might be motivating us to change the whole humanity. But to benefit from this opportunity, more people must act now. All of us must. We face a very dangerous future if global warming continues. In fact, distinguished scientists and other United Nations members have been meeting throughout this year in preparation for the December Copenhagen summit, where they hope to reach agreement on a treaty to replace the Kyoto Protocol. German Chancellor Angela Merkel was just here in Washington, D.C., making an historic address to the U.S. Congress and asked the United States to help to lead in halting climate change. I would ask the same, even though I'm not the chancellor. I'm sure many of you are aware of the increasing number of global warming effects noted worldwide. So I will share just a few from the world and from the United States. One, in the Arctic North Pole, so much ice has already melted that scientists are forecasting an ice-free summer within as little as 3 to 6 years, which would be the first time in 1 million years. Meanwhile, Greenland is shedding 85 million tons of iceberg each day due to warming, and at a rate that is increasing by 7% each year. The West Antarctic ice shelf is also melting, with 3.3 meter sea level rises forecast that would threaten cities like your country, New York, Washington, D.C., and San Francisco. And if all of Antarctica and Greenland were to melt, the ice, then the sea levels could rise to as much as 70 meters, which would be deadly or disastrous to most lives on Earth. Two, glaciers across the globe are shrinking more quickly than researchers ever expected, leaving rivers and lakes gone, disappear, or drying, with no water for crops and billions who face food shortages due to water shortages as well. Three, due to rising sea levels, islands are sinking as we speak, with Tuvalu, Tonga, and some 40 other island nations having to plan their whole country's migrations. They are being forced to join the already 20 million climate refugees today. The International Organization for Migration stated that there may be 200 million climate refugees by 2050. 4. According to researchers at Georgia Institute of Technology, United States of America, worldwide, the number of the most destructive Category 4 and 5 hurricanes doubled over the past 35 years. Category 5 storms yield the highest level of destruction in major cities. Their intensity and duration also increased by 75% since the 1970s. One of these storms whose effects can still be seen and felt was the 2005 Hurricane Katrina, which devastated especially areas of New Orleans, with people who are still recovering their homes and their lives today. I am so sorry the American people have had to suffer through such tragedies. Now, in the United States, 1. Close to 1 million acres of pine forests have been lost in the Rocky Mountains due to beetle infestation from global warming. Similar also in Canada, but due to time limit, I cannot report to you everything. So now we just report about United States. Now, 2. In the state of Montana, the famous glaciers of Glacier National Park are now expected to disappear within a decade. 3. According to a new study by the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, the Colorado River, which supplies water to 7 western states, is going dry. Famous river, huh? 4. In fact, researchers say that the U.S. West is facing a devastating drought crisis as snows from mountains are releasing vast reservoirs of water. 5. The sea level in North Carolina, USA, rose 3 times faster during the 20th century than during the previous 500 years. 6. The U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration said that for the first time on record in 2008, 6 consecutive tropical cyclones made landfall on the U.S. mainland. The North Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean are the 2 areas with the strongest hurricane trends. You may ask, what is the main cause of this damage and destruction to the environment? Perhaps, surprisingly, it's not the coal industry or cars or planes or trains or boats or ships. It's methane, which is produced primarily by the livestock industry. A new and just published report by the respected World Watch Institute states that livestock is the largest single contributor to greenhouse gases, responsible for more than 51% of the total emitted. This report factors in an atmospheric heat-trapping effect of methane that is 72 times larger than CO2 when averaged over a 20-year period. Furthermore, just days after the World Watch Institute's report was released, NASA announced that methane actually contributes much more to global warming than previously understood and it traps 100 times the atmospheric heat over 20 years. And the largest source of methane is, you know, livestock. Now, facts such as these have caused people like esteemed climate expert Lord Stern of the United Kingdom to state in an interview that meat is a wasteful use of water and creates a lot of greenhouse gases. It puts enormous pressure on the world's resources. A vegetarian diet is better. So I quote exactly what he said. Now, the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization reported that livestock raising is the single largest human use of land, the biggest source of water pollution, the number one cause of biodiversity loss, and the top producer of human-caused methane and nitrous oxide. In fact, the United Nations has named livestock as one of the biggest environmental problems of our time. With 90% of the destruction to the Amazon rainforest since 1970, being for cattle and growing animal feed, lush forests are being turned into barren fields at a rate of 36 football fields per minute. 36 football fields per minute of rainforest are being destroyed as we are speaking. If you can imagine how big that is, how detrimental that is to our world, rainforest is the lung of our planet. It's the health of our co-citizens. And as the trees are felled and plants become more exposed and dry, they even emit carbon dioxide rather than absorb it. This is another danger that attacking us. Next, meat consumption is a very serious threat to human health. You ask any scientist, they tell you this. You ask all the responsible doctors, they'll tell you this. In fact, one of the doctors sitting there, Dr. Greger, I saw him there. Now, bacterial infections from foodborne illnesses originate largely in animal products, causing widespread illnesses, disability, and even death for thousands of Americans each year. The top four bacteria are E. coli, Salmonella, Campylobacter, and Listeriosis. Studies have shown that bacteria from contaminated raw meat can remain even after washing a working surface. And it only takes a few cells of E. coli, for example, to kill a young child. Just a few cells of E. coli to kill a young child. A young, little, tender child. Imagine that. Just a few cells. Add to that the leading causes of death in the United States, like from heart disease, cancer, diabetes, obesity. Every year, heart disease kills 632,000 Americans. Cancer kills 560,000 Americans. Stroke kills another 130,000 Americans. Diabetes kills 72,000 Americans. Just from meat eating. And we cry over war-related deaths. Who cries for these hundreds of thousands of Americans who die because of that piece of meat? Who cry for those young, helpless, innocent little child who die just because of meat-related E. coli just a few cells of it. So, ladies and gentlemen, meat is the worst killer than any war. Don't you agree? Yes or no? Thank you. Thank you. Then there are more diseases related to the production of the meat, like swine flu, which Dr. Michael Greger just explained very clearly, originates from animal farms, and the next pandemic, which could emerge any day now, any minute, could be worse for us, could be worse than swine flu. So, sir, to solve this, we do need to move quickly, and of course we know what to do, right? Yes? Be vegan. You know, yes or no?
Yes.
Thank you. Wonderful people. Wonderful. You make my day. There is an advantage of time here, because one aspect of methane is that it dissipates in around 12 years' time, whereas carbon dioxide, CO2, stays in the atmosphere for up to thousands of years. So we remove the livestock-generated methane and the planet cools fast. You see the logic? From many scientific studies, the health benefits of the vegan lifestyle are already clear. And there are entire communities, such as Village of Peace in Israel, where thousands of vegan residents are free of diseases, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, and even cancer. In the country of Ghana, there is a similar program where, after becoming vegan for more than 20 years now, the villagers, the entire village, don't have malaria anymore. And you know how malaria attacked those countries in Africa, yes. And the previous high infant mortality rate went down to zero. Before, high infant mortality rate, zero. Yes. I also applaud this program. So please pray with me, Mr. Pelletier, that everyone does wake up in time. Pray, I pray day and night, that the divine manifest in the physical realm and wake up the leaders of our nations, wake up the religious head, wake up everybody in time, so that they understand the urgency of our situation and that they understand the solution of solving this dangerous crisis facing us. That is, we have to turn back to our caring and compassionate nature inside our heart. That's very simple. We are that. We are compassion. We are merciful. We are caring. So we just have been cheated. We have been misinformed up to now. So we did not know it. Being vegan worldwide is the advancement of compassion that will uplift and unify all cultures, bringing tranquility to humans and animals alike. The inner peace that comes from replacing killing with respect for all life will spread like a wave across the globe, elevate human hearts, and create a harmonious Eden on Earth. That will bring us all to a lasting golden era. Bless you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm positive we will do it. Yes? We can make it. Just a little change. Just a little change. Just a little piece of animal meat. Change to vegetable protein. We have plenty nowadays. We have vegetarian sausage. We have vegetarian all kind of chicken, shrimp, look alike, taste better. Thank you. I love Washington, D.C. I love Washington people. You are so elite. Thank you.
Our next questioner is Mr. Bob Levinson, producer and radio host of a program called Environmentally Sound on WVOX Radio in New York. In fact, Mr. Levinson and Supreme Master Ching Hai know each other because he recently interviewed her on his program.
Right.
Hi, Master.
Hi, Bob.
It's good to see you again. Good to be with you again.
How are you, Bob?
I'm great. It's very nice to be here. I'm glad your people invited me. You have a great crew here, great staff.
Good audience, eh? They are so good.
Yes, very good.
I feel such a love and supportive atmosphere. Okay, go ahead, Bob.
Okay, my question is, I still don't quite understand what you mean by leap to the golden era. What does the term leap actually mean? What makes it happen? And what does the golden era mean to us here on Earth?
Oh, you don't know leap, Bob? I'm sure you know. You just asked for so that you can have some interesting thing to talk on your radio show, right? Yeah. Leap.
Actually, I asked them because I would like to understand what this is about. It's called the Humanity's Leap to the Golden Era. And I would like to know just how you see it, what it means in your terms, because you are the inspirational spark for this whole gathering.
All right, sure. Aye, sir. I will comply.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Very thought-provoking. I shall try my best to explain what is meant by humanity's leap to the golden era. The leap is a big jump, eh? That could bring humankind from one incorrect way of life to a better way of life, to the next higher level, in a short time. You see, one small step from everyone in the right direction can result in a big leap in our evolution as a human race. And that small step is very simple. It's just no killing. Abiding by the principle of live and let live. Adhering to the universal law where we grant life to beget life, because like attract like, that's we all know. This, of course, includes adopting a vegan diet. Humans are naturally more generous and peaceful in their heart. It's just that we all have been misinformed, misunderstood for a long, long, long time. We thought meat is good for us. We thought dairy is good for us. We thought fish is good for us. We thought eggs is good for us. It's all wrong. It's all the opposite. It all has been proven that these things that we have been told that good for us, like meat, fish, dairy, eggs, whatever animal products are good for us, is all wrong. It's the opposite of what is good. It has been bringing us suffering, sickness, and tremendous loss of financial from taxpayers for curing disease and related business. So we have been misled for a long, long time. Now we have to do research. We have to listen to the wise doctors and scientists. We have to see that the result of their research, that meat and animal products are really, really poisonous for us. We have to stop now, especially stop for our children's sake. We can't keep poisoning our children anymore. They're helpless. The poor children, they rely on us. They thought we know better. But it's not our fault either. You know, we just need to turn around. Why is not our fault? Because we have been also taught that way. And our grandparents, our great-grandparents also been taught that way. And for being too busy for our daily survival, working, we have no time to do research. So that we did not know that these things are truly poisonous to us. And above all, it is eating up our planet. It's not just killing people, it's not just killing animals, it's killing our planet. And we have to stop it in order to save our world. We just turn around, that's it. Just walk the opposite way, the right way, without causing any more suffering, no taking more lives, but loving and protecting all creatures. That's the leap. that our humanity needs. Thank you. We will feel completely different after we make this leap. We will feel evolved to the higher level of consciousness automatically. Just imagine we are big, strong, intelligent, and able. We are able to plan all kind of stuff to eat. And we should not use our might, our intelligence, our capability to harass, to molest, to torture, to cause suffering, and to murder those little, helpless, innocent animals who has never done us any harm. According to the law, they are innocent. And if we kill innocent beings, we are the one who should be punished. I am sorry if I offend you, but this is the truth. And I'm sure you understand it. Thank you. Through our leap in this evolution, we can live this existence of want and fear toward a true life of peace and love and enlightenment. From the vicious cycle of killing, suffering, and violence to a circle of loving kindness, protection, and happiness. Can we imagine a world where the meek ones never have to fear the strong? Where there is no more violence, no fighting among neighbors, near or far, and no child has to die of hunger, thirst, or illness every few seconds, every day, while their mother watches, completely helpless, with her heart drowning in sorrow. As I am speaking, many children are dying somewhere. Every few seconds, a child dies of hunger. We cannot keep doing this. We cannot wait longer. We have to save these lives. Not just the lives of animals, but the life of our children. Even if it's not our children, other people's children. Meat causes so much suffering because it causes hunger and war. We use up all our cereals, grain, soil, and good resources, and land and water to support the meat industry. And therefore, the world is short of food and water. So in order to save lives, we have to stop the meat industry. The way we are living right now is a deeply degraded condition of what we really are. We are the children of God, which is all loving and kindness. We are the heirs of heaven. We're just forgotten. Can you imagine a God who comes here to earth and kill everything in sight to eat? Sorry if there's a God like that. I don't want to be his child. Would you like to be the children of that kind of God? Tell me yes or no.
No!
Okay, no. Thank you. Thank you. You're so kind. Now, if God is all merciful, all compassionate, all loving, and we are the children of God, then don't you think we should walk like God children on earth? We have to walk the way of love and compassion. We have to represent our Father if we want to glorify His name. We always pray every day, you know, hallowed be thy name in heaven as well as on earth. But what do we do to hallow His name? We have to represent Him. We always pray to God because we believe God is merciful, protective, compassionate, and loving. And we are the children of God. We must represent these qualities. We are that qualities. We are loving and kindness. We have just been misled, misinformed, and we have forgotten. So please just remember, these qualities are deep inside us, so we know. There must be something better than what we see around us. We do have examples through our history of human beings whose lives were so uplifting that they continue to shine till today. Not only spiritual teachers, but philosophers like Plato, statesmen like Socrates, the mathematician Pythagoras, and the poet Ralph Waldo Emerson of America. They are all vegetarian. Are you surprised? No, you're not. You don't look surprised to me. So you knew all that. All the great people, they are vegetarian or vegan. So, if we study them carefully, we will see that at the basic core of the civilized life, they taught is the vegan diet. The vegan diet is one of the first single greatest acts of compassion, of not harming another life and not damaging the environment even. If we compare a meat-based diet to a vegan diet, it takes around 14 times as much water, 6 times as much grain, 10 times as much energy, and over 20 times as much land, while often destroying precious rainforests. Being vegan is good business in terms of virtuous merit, as well as preserving the only home we have. The less damage and harm we inflict upon the planet and her inhabitants, the less we have to pay. We are paying dearly now, and we will pay much dearer if we don't stop the meat animal industry. The more we exert our loving kindness and protection towards all beings, the greater we will be in the world, the greater will be the feeling in our heart, as well as in the kingdom of heaven.
European Parliament supports reducing meat to lower greenhouse gases.
Reduce your meat consumption or stop eating meat totally.
During discussions on greenhouse gas reduction goals, the Climate Committee of the European Parliament officially recognized livestock's contribution to global warming and recommended a reduction of subsidies to the livestock industry to curb methane.
The European Parliament has adopted its own position on climate change as an institution. And as a vice president, one of the proposals I have made is in line with your own, which is that we should eat far less meat, because that's one of the major sources of greenhouse gases.
Tout le monde sait bien, si on veut rendre notre planète soutenable, il va falloir réduire notre consommation de viande, ça on le sait bien.
My name is Jens Holm, I'm a member of the European Parliament. Please, be veg, go green to save the planet.
That's why great masters and other illuminated souls of the past all taught us one and the same, that if we don't wish to be harmed, we must not impose harm on others. You look on all religion, all say the same in this sentence, this same meaning. Whatever is good for us, we should do for others. That whatever we sow, we will reap without fail. That's why they did teach us not to eat animals and to be vegan. If we make this leap, very small change in the diet. Instead of meat, instead of animal protein, we choose vegetable protein, which is first class anyway. Animal protein is second class. Why? Because they have eaten the first class vegetable and fruit, and then we eat their flesh. That is second class. We are human. Why do we choose a second class stuff? Huh? It doesn't befit us. So we have to make this leap. Thank you. My God, you are so kind. We have to make this leap, ladies and gentlemen, because if we do, the golden era will be here in no time, heralding a time of peaceful living without the perpetual loss of lives, early death, in the tens of billions each year, my God. Torture and murder for our fleeting pleasure, which we could always replace. Meat is replaceable. There are so many wonders of earthly life that we have yet to experience and discover, so much scientific knowledge to be revealed and explored and invented, and incredible technologies to be discover and develop. There are better social systems. There are things mostly beyond our present level of logic or even our imagination. But they can only be achieved through tapping into our wisdom and creative power. In order to open this wisdom, we must first remove the harmful, obstructive substance that block and suppress it, like meat, dairy, fish, poultry, and all animal products. These things obstruct our intelligence, delay our progress, not just spiritually, morally, but technologically as well. Finally, besides our personal reasons wanting to welcome a golden era, we also have the planet to consider, which, as I'm sure you know, we are at risk of losing any time now. So this leap in consciousness is also to save our planet and all other beings that deserve a harmonious world to live in. Everyone make this leap or shift. We can save our planet. I promise, with all the honor that I have, and God be witness. At the same time, we elevate ourselves, which has been long, long overdue. Thank you, Bob, for making me talk so much.
Thank you, Supreme Master.
The Washington people are very polite, you know, they are very polite, educated people. Thanks so much.
Thank you for explaining the truth so clearly and for encouraging us to do the right thing.
Our next questioner became a vegan a few years ago when he realized that it was a more compassionate and noble way of living. Mr. Alex Arndt, songwriter, musician, and lead singer of the band Sonic Paradigm, now promotes the vegan diet through his songs.
Hello. Hello, everyone.
Hi, Supreme Master Qinghai. Hello.
Hi, Alex.
Hello. I just want to say thank you for being my fan. I am also a big fan of yours.
Oh.
And I am so happy to ask you this question. Okay.
Please.
My question is, as a musician, it seems to me that one of the most powerful things is art in our world, and it connects us as human souls. Why do you think this is? Does the beauty of art remind us of another more noble way of life? Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Sure, Alex. Sure. But it's so nice to see you. A smart, handsome, compassionate musician, voice of the voiceless, torchbearer for many people. I'm one of your fans as well, you know. I wish you all the best as you continue to write and sing from your heart. Your songs are very touching and ringing with heartfelt truth and feeling, like there are no slaughterhouses in the spiritual world. So why would we want any on earth, right? That's it. Your songs are powerful. Very powerful, and art is powerful. You know that. Art can speak to us deep inside without any explanation and language. It just goes straight to our heart. It can elevate a person's mood, dissolving the barriers of prejudice or preconceived notions and going beyond the need for human language for perfect expression. And you know, Alex, artists like you are considered half saints already. You are a vegan artist, so perhaps you are more than 50%, huh? Congratulations. Oh, aren't they nice? I could talk forever in this kind of, atmosphere. The artists are able to emulate the heavenly melodies and the beauties from above and try to express them on earth as much as they can through their physical instruments and vocal. Because in heaven, everything is so glorious and beyond imagination, full of divine light and celestial sound of music. That is what we call the higher vibrations of the universe, which we can hear anytime. Like now, I'm speaking to you. I don't have any instrument, and nobody is playing any harp around here, but I can hear the heavenly music at the same time. The inside melody, this music, is a real music, is a real inspiration behind all the greatest composition on this planet. Yes, I know it because I myself experienced. Yes. In ancient times, the spiritual practitioners who are connected to heaven at times try to replicate the mesmerizing, wonderful music of the celestial abode by creating instruments. So many of the instruments we have, like the harp, the piano, the violin, the flute, the Scottish bagpipes, etc., they all correlate with the sounds of real heavenly realms. Except the real ones are much more incredibly uplifting for this matter. I know it because I can compare, because I hear the inner music and I can hear your outside music or other artists' music, so I can compare, yes. Though the paints and the gold and precious gems can never be as brilliant as the ones in God's kingdom, they also still help to remind people of their glorious divine nature or awaken to something beyond the ordinary world. So all artists help to awaken the noble qualities within human. So you're right to say that the beauty of art does remind us of our real home. It's not just the aesthetic pleasure, but it resonates with our origin. The beauties we adore so much are us. The nobility, love, and compassion are us. Therefore, we are grateful to the artists such as yourself who have enriched our lives through their beautiful contributions. Let's continue working together until we create our own spiritual world paradise. Hey, Alex, thank you. Heaven bless you.
Thank you.
Continue with your music.
And we thank you, Supreme Master Qinghai, for your words are actually artistic to our souls. They're music. It's heavenly. And we are moved with the compassion and passion of what your wisdom is all about. So thank you once again.
Our next questioner is also a musician. He goes by the pen name Da Vinci and is renowned for his dynamic form of hip-hop. He's most notable for doing many things simultaneously and can even play music with his feet and face.
Thank you. I'm here with my group, Soliloquists of Sound, and we've dedicated our lives as both people and musicians to inspire everyone to recognize a power that they have as individuals. And it feels really great to be among so many other people that have dedicated their lives to the same thing. So thanks to everyone here,
as well as Supreme Master Qinghai.
Can you comment on the children that are being born these days, children like Akiani? They seem to be born with great gifts and maturity and wisdom that's well beyond their years. What is their role in this time?
Yes, I'd be glad to inform you. You just remember there was one little beautiful girl, Akian Kamarik, yes, okay. She's one of the what we call Indigo children, or crystal children. They're born from a different dimension, from a higher dimension. But unlike us, they have the ability to retain their divinity, or at least some part of it, so that they can bring to this world some different gift for us. Yes, we are all born from different dimension, Mr. Da Vinci. We are all divine. We are all born from a higher level of consciousness, for what I know. It's just we have been degraded. We have come to this world and we have been confused. And the negative force of this realm has been deluded us and make us into what we have not willed to be. We should have been much better than what we are. That's why we are never satisfied with ourselves. No matter how much money we have, no matter how successful, big house, big car, something inside us always makes us feel something missing. Yes, something we don't know what. That is our divine origin trying to wake us up. Indigo children are the children who has exceptional talent for their age. They know more way beyond their years. And people who have studied or spent time with these special gifted children have told us about them. These are the youth who are born from higher dimensions and can retain some part of their intelligence, their wisdom, and their talent, their quality of the higher dimension. Yes. Many children don't have to be indigo children. From the time of their birth until about 3-4 years of age, many of children still can remember heaven. Sometimes they talk with each other about heaven. Sometimes they told parents about heaven, but the parents would not listen, would not understand, because the parents have already forgotten. After 3-4 years of age, we have forgotten our origin. So the indigo children are the ones who still continue to remember after 4 or 5 years of age. Lucky for them, yes. Perhaps heaven's will to let these children come and remember their divine quality so that we have hope, so to remind us that we could attain like that. We could be like them, or perhaps we were like them. Yes, we are like them, Mr. Da Vinci. Through my meditation, through my search, heaven and earth, I know we are all divine, Mr. Da Vinci. If only I can show it to you. If only I can let you know what I know. If only I can remove all the obstructive substance that many of us have been misled and put into this temple, the divine temple, and blur our consciousness. That's the reason we have forgotten our godly origin. That's the reason why we forgot that we are truly the children of God. We all heard that we are children of God, but we don't know it. We don't really know it because we obstructed ourselves. Because the negative force in this world is too heavy, they kind of surround us, they kind of oppress us, that we could not struggle to fight against it. And then we succumb to this negative force and degrade ourselves more and more every day. That's why many masters came to this planet since times immemorial to try to lift us up, to try to remind us. But the thing is, it's not that easy because we have been sleeping too long. Now, we're talking about the children, that they have retained some part of their divinity. Okay. They come because they found that the atmosphere, perhaps on our planet, has become more suitable, more refined, and brighter for them. Our planet has been changing recently for the better, you see, as more and more people are doing virtuous deeds, practice deep meditation, spiritual disciplines, and adopting the compassionate vegan lifestyle. Nowadays, because of the communication so advanced, so the vegan lifestyle or spiritual lifestyle spread very easily, unlike the time of Jesus. So nowadays, we don't have those harassment from misunderstanding like the time of Jesus or the time of Prophet Muhammad. Also, our human evolution has benefited from the spiritual masters who have been gracing our earth throughout history to bless us. So the atmosphere of our world today has become more purified, despite the setback that we have also at the same time due to the uncompassionate way that we have been misled into living. Nevertheless, the part that can be purified, it has been purified. So our planet atmosphere has been receptive, uplifted to these higher dimensional levels. So some higher dimensional beings can come here. Perhaps more in the future, these so-called indigo or crystal children have come to join us. As we continue to purify our world, we will have more and more of them. They serve as innocent inspiration and reminder toward our own innate higher qualities. As we see their good energy, creativity, intelligence, wisdom, and love put into practice. For some of us who may not know much about these young people, I explain a little more. These children, they are born with many talents, including both artistic and technological, way beyond their tender age. Their faith in the divine gives them a simple but clear sense of life's purpose. And not only do they share their creative talents freely with the world, but they also have a lot of inborn virtues. Their nature is of unwavering honesty that can never be compromised by this world. They're lucky. They dislike suffering and injustice. They have more or less telepathic talents. They have intuitive feeling, very strong. Yes. So they're very sensitive to other people's feelings and animals' feelings. Oftentimes, they could communicate with animals since young age already. Because their purity naturally repels substances such as chemicals, pollution, and unwholesome foods. These children are also vegetarian or vegan by their own choice, since very, very young, as their nobler selves would only allow them to be so. So their presence is a blessing, is a gift for the continued development of our world. And at the same time, they are an encouraging signal that our planet is on an elevating path. We can only wish that more and more of them may come, and better yet, that more and more of their wonderful qualities will emerge in every one of us. Even as ordinary adults, we can cultivate spiritual consciousness still. Our creativity, intelligence, and other abilities similar to what we see in these indigo children. We all have the capacity and potential to be higher beings. We have just been suppressed by incorrect choices in life. We have been poisoning ourselves by misinformation. But all these wonderful quality, divinity, can be awakened anytime. I know that because I have my own experience. I wasn't born enlightened. You see, I searched for enlightenment and I reached it at around 30 years of age, a similar age of the Buddha. Buddha wasn't born enlightened despite all the myths about him. You see, we still have a chance. In our group, many people older than you practice spiritual meditation, and they regain their divinity just the same like the indigo or more even. So we have choices. We have chance. We can do anything we want because we are the children of God. Just believe it. It's truly like that. Now, back to Earth. We can always regain all this divinity. Truly, I promise you with all honesty and honor that we can have it. Every of you sitting there, whatever age you are, if you don't even have any experience about heaven, you don't even have any talent before, you don't even know what to meditate. But any of you can attain this divinity again, reclaim it again, provided we have the right counteraction, see? And the first step is to switch to a more compassionate lifestyle, because that is what we are. We are compassion. A compassionate vegan diet is the basic way of higher being, a mark of a true human being. A true human being would never kill. A true being would never harm another, even if his own life is threatened. A real gentleman steps wisely, understanding that all beings are connected, and that by taking a life, compromising his own human spirit and bringing the bad retribution of killing upon him. So it is not solely the responsibility of these children to improve the world's consciousness level. We must all work together to bring heaven closer to earth. We can all do it. It's so simple. In my group, even children 5, 6 years old can meditate and can hear the inside melody, can talk to God. If we want to bring heaven to earth, if that is our wish, so shall it be. Thank you and bless you for being a vegetarian, Mr. Da Vinci.
Thank you.
Many thanks, Supreme Master Qinghai, for the scope of your vision and for reminding us that we are all God's children.
Some of the diseases related to meat consumption and or production: rabies, anthrax, sleeping sickness, Q fever, norovirus, swine flu, Ebola Reston virus. Cured meats and fish increase leukemia risk in children. Antibiotic-resistant superbug infections from a strain of Staphylococcus aureus, blue tongue disease, E. coli, Salmonella, bird flu, mad cow disease, or Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, 90% of the population at risk, pig's disease, or PMWS, listeriosis, shellfish poisoning, pre-eclampsia, Campylobacter, Clostridium difficile, diseases hidden in healthy-appearing livestock, some of the costs of meat eating. Infertility, eating just one serving of meat per day increases the risk of women's infertility by 32%, with additional meat consumption increasing the risk. Heart disease, over 17 million lives lost globally each year. Cost of cardiovascular disease is at least $1 trillion a year. Cancer, increased childhood cancers and adult reproductive cancers from hormones in meat. Colon rectal cancer. Over 1 million new colon cancer patients diagnosed each year. More than 600,000 colon cancer-related mortalities annually. In the United States alone, colon cancer treatment costs about $6.5 billion. Millions of people are newly diagnosed with other meat-related cancers every year.
Diabetes. 246 million people are affected worldwide. An estimated $174 billion spent each year on treatment in just the United States. Obesity. Worldwide, 1.6 billion adults are overweight, with 400 million more who are obese. Costs $93 billion each year for medical expenses in the United States alone. At least 2.6 million people die annually from problems related to being overweight or obese. Environmental. Uses up to 70% of clean water. Pollutes most of the water bodies. Deforests the lungs of the earth. Uses up to 43% of the world's cereal. Uses up to 85% of the world's soy. Causes world hunger and wars. 80% cause of global warming. Plus more.
Some of the costs of milk consumption: cowpox from milking cows, bacterial microbes, pesticides and enzymes found in cheese derived from the inner stomach linings of other animals. Up to 80% of the calories in cheese are from pure fat. Breast, prostate and testicular cancer from hormones present in milk. Listeria and Crohn's disease. hormones, and saturated fat leads to osteoporosis, obesity, diabetes, and heart disease, linked to higher incidences of multiple sclerosis, classified as a major allergen, lactose intolerance, plus more.
For more urgent information, please visit www.suprememastertv.com/killers. For help quitting, please visit...
What did you think of today's conference? What kind of impact did it have on you?
I loved every minute of it. It's the same message that we've always been speaking about. It's now just a lot more prevalent, I would think, when that's love. And, of course, be vegan. I don't think people really should be calling vegans vegans. I think they should just be calling them passionate people who believe in saving the planet. So if you want to save the planet, then you know what to do.
Veganism is a great way to take on climate change, for sure.
And what is your impression of Supreme Master Qinghai, given the fact that you just heard her speak?
She seemed really nice, really, really nice. And like I said, you know, she makes a great point about the vegan diet. And that combined with, you know, moving away from fossil fuels and towards clean, renewable resources, making sure we pay attention to science-based solutions, that's exactly how we're going to create a peaceful, green future.
Tell me your impressions of the conference tonight.
I am most impressed with the interaction between the questioners and Master Qinghai, in that the interaction helps us to become more intimate with her. She was very explanatory about her own pursuit of her own divinity and her sharing herself with the audience tonight. I think one of the great messages early on expressed by Qinghai is that it starts with us, the individual, and the collective individual action would perhaps have the greatest impact. We have our own mandate to spread that message amongst our own, but also to those who we contact wherever we should find them.
Has always been an issue that I've been worried about, but I never had very much information about it. And so it was great to be able to come here today. You know, I always knew that the meat industry had an impact on our climate, but I didn't realize, you know, for example, that 18% of greenhouse gases is a result of the meat that we eat. And so I'm really gonna take that home with me. I'm also gonna consider how much dairy I eat. And I also wish that other people could get this information, because I think that if they knew more about what was told today, they would change their diet as well.
I know the sub focus and much of I guess the subtext was on climate change, but the larger theme was the golden era, and frankly I think that was the most important. The fact that Supreme Master Qinghai has held a conference in the Capitol, declaring that this is what we're up to, I think is a first, and I give her all the credit in the world for doing that. Thank you, and thank you for that. You're working for her TV station to do that. You truly are creating leadership in the world through that. So I thank the conference for bringing attention to these really vital issues. Thanks you so much to you, to the whole TV station, to Master Qinghai for holding this groundbreaking conference in Washington, D.C.
The whole conference was really enlightening. I really liked it. It was unimaginable. You know, I love to be 100% vegetarian now. I am deciding already to enjoy eating this, and I really liked it.
Be veg.
Go green.
Save the planet.
And Alex, what are your impressions of the conference that you saw today? What are you taking away from it?
I have a much better understanding of who Supreme Master Qinghai is, because I've known her, I've seen her, but just getting to really look into her eyes today and see her compassion and her emotion was really special for me. Just spectacular conference. I loved it. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Alex Arndt.
I'm the singer from the Sonic Paradigm. Be veg, go green, and save the planet today.